Hi all, in this lecture we will see about introduction to testing, then also we will see unit testing, and in unit testing we will see black box testing. So the aim of this program testing is to find out the defects in the program. So we have to find out the different errors that can happen in the program. So what we do is we try to execute a program with a set of test inputs and observe if the program behaves as expected. So if we know the input and if we know what will be the output, we will give the input and we will check whether we are getting the actual output. So that is meant by testing. So we will give some input to the system and we will see the response whether we are getting the actual output. So if failed, then input data and conditions and under which it failed are noted for error correction. So we will note down which all conditions and which all input data the system has failed, and then we have to correct that data. So that is what is known as testing. So this is different from code review. In code review we won't be running the program. Here we will be running the program by giving some set of inputs. So we will be designing all these test cases, and we will be giving these test cases to the program and check whether we are getting the correct output. So there are some testing terminologies that are used. So these are actually IEEE standard glossary for this software testing. So first one is mistake. So it is essentially any programmer action that later shows up an incorrect result during program execution. So it is mistake is actually a programmer action that later shows some incorrect result. So if this programmer may commit a mistake during any development activity, for example, when he code, he might make a division by zero or something like or array out of bound. All these are mistakes made by the programmer. So this will turn up into an error. Then second is error. So error, it is a result of a mistake committed by a developer. So we use several names for this error. It can be a bug, it can be called bug, fault, defect are all synonyms, even though fault is actually used only for hardware systems. So all these are synonyms of this error. So error is it is because of the result of a mistake. So if a programmer commits a mistake, then it results in an error. Okay, then next is failure. So failure of a program, it denotes incorrect behavior exhibited by the program during its execution. So this incorrect behavior might be observed as an incorrect result produced or an inappropriate activity carried out by the program. So every failure is caused by some errors in the program. Okay, so if there is some errors or bugs in the program, then automatically the system or the software will fail. Okay, there are different kinds of failure. For example, a program crashes on some input, or the robot fails to turn rightwards, or fails to jump, or it might collide with an obstacle. All these are failures of due to these errors and all. Then next terminology is test case. So it is a triplet pair. It is a triplet pair I, S and R, where I is the data input to the program under test, S is the state of the program, and R is the result expected to be produced by the program. So this is the test case. So we have to design this test cases. So what should be the input, what is the state of the program, and what will be the result, what is the expected result. So S can be considered as the execution mode of the program also. So for example, if you are using term text editor, so there might be different execution modes like edit, view, or create, or save. All these are different execution modes. So if we click edit, then whether the input is click edit, then the system state is edit or window should be open. Then if we type some ABC, if we are getting that result, then ABC will be displayed, then the R will be ABC displayed on the screen. Like that, it will consist of triplet pair I, S and R. So we have to design these test cases. The next terminology is test script. So test script, it is an encoding of a test case, or we write some short program. We'll encode all these test cases in a short program so that we can run this test scripts. So it is actually an automated execution of the test cases. Then we have a positive test case. So it is to test whether the software correctly performs the required functionality. So if we are designing some test case so that we want to get, we'll check whether we get the correct result, then it is known as positive test case. Then there is negative test case, to test whether the software carries out something that is not required by the system. Then it is known as test case, negative test case. Then there is test suite. So it is a set of all tests that have been designed by the tester to test a given program. So all the test cases together will be called as a test suite. Then testability, it is a degree to which implementation is tested. So how much we test, that is known as testability. So we have to test both the functionality of the system and also the performance of the system. So that is meant by testability of the system. Then failure mode of a system. So it's an observable way in which it can fail. So it is a, it denotes an observable way it can fail. Or in other words, we can say that all failures that have similar observable symptoms constitute a failure mode. Example, if we are booking some seat, if we are booking some railway booking software is there, there might be some failure modes like fail to book some available seat, or we may not be booking the actual seat number, or there might be a system crash. All these are known as failure modes. Then there is equivalent fault. So two faults are said to be equivalent if they result in the same failure mode. So if we are writing a program and if we try to do division by zero, then the system will crash. And if there is some other error, like if we try to access in illegal memory, then also the system will crash. Then we can say that both are equivalent faults, because whenever these two faults occur, the system crashes. So it results in the same fault. Then we will see the difference between verification and validation. So verification, it determines whether output of one phase confirms to that of previous phase. So this is known as verification. We have to determine whether the output of one phase of software development confirms to that of its previous state. Whereas validation, it is a process of determining whether a fully developed software conforms to its requirements specification, that is to the SRS, whether we are developing the correct requirements. And verification can be done using review, simulation and testing, and validation can be done through system testing, that is we have to test the whole system, then only we can say whether we are we have done all the requirements that is mentioned in the SRS document. So validation requires execution of the complete software, whereas verification requires need not run the whole software. So verification deals with phase containment of error. So we try to we have already seen what is this phase containment. So we try to eliminate the error in that phase itself. So if there is some error occurring in the design phase, we try to eliminate the error there itself, then that is known as verification. So we try to review that design document and we will find out whether there is any error in the design document. So there is some error, we will contain that error in that phase itself. So that is known as verification. And in validation, we will check whether deliverable software is error free. So that is known as validation. Then testing activities. So next is testing activities. We will see what are the testing activities that are usually there. So after completion of coding, design document and SRS, from all these documents, we can design the test suite. That is the set of all the test cases. This is known as design the test suite. So we will design the test suite. So it is a set of test cases using which a program is to be tested. Okay. Then what we do is we will run the, we have a test suite and we will run the test cases and check the results to detect the failures. So we will run all the, we will run all the test cases and check whether some failure has occurred. So if failures have, failure has occurred, then we have to list out all the failures here. So we'll be listing out all the failures, and after listing out these failures, we try to debug the program. So we have to locate the error. So if some failure has occurred, we have to locate that error. So we have to debug the program. So we will find out the errors and we will correct that errors, and again that corrected program is again tested. Like that, this will be repeated. So this is the actual test design activity. So after completing all this, we have to have this design test suite should be there. We will run all these test cases and we will note down the failures, and we have to debug the program, find out the errors, correct those errors, we will get the corrected program, and this is again tested. So why do we want to design this test cases? So this is an important thing. So we should design the test cases. So when this test cases are developed based on, so we can simply develop these test cases based on some random values. But the problem is many of them do not contribute to significance of test case. So many of them do not contribute to the test case actually. They do not help to detect additional defects also. So for example, we will see one example. If x greater than y, max is equal to x. We have a statement like this. Or and we have a statement like else max equal to x also. Now there's some error. We know that we have some error here. X, we are trying to find out which is greater, whether x or y is greater. So if x is greater than y, then max should be x. And in the else part, max equal to should be y. Here we have made a mistake. We have given as x itself. So if you are designing, giving some test case like this, so we have to give test case like x equal to 3, y equal to 2, and x equal to 2, y equal to 3. If this is used, then automatically this error will be detected. Now if you are giving some text case like this, x equal to 3, y equal to 2, x equal to 4, y equal to 3, and x equal to 5 and y equal to y, so this won't detect this error because we are giving all greater values for x. So this error won't be detected. So it is not the number of test cases that should be given. We have to find out all the defects in the program. So we have to design test cases such that all the defects in the program will be listed, found out. So in this way, we have to find out or determine or design this test case. Okay. So we should not design this test cases random by giving some random values. And this test case should be minimal test suite. That is, it is a set of test cases that each test case helps to detect different errors. So if you have 10 test cases, then 10 test cases will be detecting 10 different errors. So we should design test suite like that. Then only it will be a good test suite. So we have two approaches for designing these test cases. One is black box and functional testing. Then second is, so in black box or functional testing, what we do is we will find out the fundamental specification, use the fundamental specification of the software, and we will consider the input and output behavior. And the second type is white box or glass box testing. So here we will find whether there is some error in the internal structure of the program. So we will check whether there is any errors in the internal structure of the program. So we have to analyze the code. So that is why the name here, black box. Black box means it is black of color. So we cannot see anything inside. So we cannot see what is inside the code. So we will just check the functionality of the system. So if there is a code, and if that code is to check if that code is designed to perform login operation, So what we do is, we'll simply give username and password and check whether it is correctly logging in. But in the case of white box texting, we have to check the internal structure of the code. So all the lines of code will be checked whether there is some error in the inside the code. It is not only, we will not only check the functionality, but also the inside, we will analyze the code also. Next is testing in large versus testing small. So there are three levels of testing. First one is unit testing. We call it as testing in small. That is, whenever a module is completed, that module will be tested unit wise. So all the individual programmers will be testing based on those test cases. Then there is integration testing. We call it as testing in large, because when all the unit, all the modules are unit tested, we have to integrate, or we have to combine these modules, individual modules, so that, and we have to integrate and we have to combine these modules, and we have to check whether that integration is working correctly, because there might be some interfaces or interfaces between these modules. You have to check whether the correct function call is happening, whether this function is calling the other function, and whether that function is returning the correct value to this function. Like that, we have to check. So that is done in the integration testing, that is known as testing in large. Then after completion of this testing, we have to perform the system testing. That is, the whole system should be tested for various kinds of errors. So these are the three types of testing, levels of testing: unit testing, integration testing, and system testing. So here we first test each modules, then integrate them and test, and on completing the system testing is carried out. So we will see what is the unit testing. So it is undertaken after each module have been coded and reviewed. So this is undertaken after each module have been coded, and also it has been reviewed. So here what are tested is, we will test procedures belonging to other module that the module under test calls. We have to check whether this module, this procedure, we have to test procedures belonging to other modules that the module under test calls. That is, if we have a module and this module is calling some other module, then we have to check whether this module will be actually calling that module. Then non-local data structure that the module uses. So this module might be using some global variables or some non-local data structure, that is some data structures that is there in another module or another function. So we have to check whether it is working correctly. Then also a procedure to call the function of module under test with parameters. That is, this module might be invoked by some other module. So we have to check whether that module can be called from that module. So we have to check whether this module can be called by some other module. So we have to check all these things. That is, if we have a module, this module might be invoking some other modules. We have to check whether it is correctly invoking all those modules. Then also, this module might be accessing some non-local data structures. We have to check whether that is possible. Then the third thing we have to check is, this module might be called by some other module. So we have to check whether those modules are able to call this module. So in order to perform this module, so we have to do this unit testing after that module is completed. So if this is the module under test, so we have to check what all things we have to check is, one thing, there will be some module which is calling this module. We have to check whether this calling is working. So this module might be invoking some other module. So you have to check whether that module call is working. Also, this module might be invoking some global variables. So we have to check whether that global access is also possible. So this module is complete, but this module and this module might not be complete at that time. So this might be under development by some other person. So what we do is, we develop a stub module and driver module. So stub is actually a dummy procedure that is called by this module under test. So this is actually a module, but that module is not completely developed. So that is under development. So, but we have to test this module also. So, what we do is, we develop a dummy module. So, this might be a simple table. So, we simply try to pass that parameter, whatever that, or we try to invoke that function call. If it is a function, we try to call this function. So, we'll check from this program whether this function can be called. And there is a driver module. So, it contains non-local data structures accessed by the module under test. And also, it has the code to call different functions of the unit under test. So, this might have some functions that will be calling this function, this module. So, we will have the non-local data structure and also those functions which are invoking this module. So, we will so these are all dummy modules. So, this module is also not complete. This is also under development. But we have to test this module. Then what you have to do? We make some dummy modules and test this module. So that is known as driver and stub module. Okay. So we will develop a driver dummy module and also a stub dummy module to check, to test this module. Next, you will see black box testing. So what we do is, in black box testing, we will check, examine the input output behavior of the system. So if we give some input values, we'll check whether we are getting the actual output. So that is known as black box testing. We will simply check the functionality. So if this functionality is working or not, that is what is checked in the black box testing. So this is also, this is a kind of unit testing. So we have two approaches in black box testing. One is equivalence class partitioning and second is boundary value analysis. So, we will see both methods. First one is equivalence class partitioning. Equivalence class partitioning. So, what we do is, domain of input is partitioned into a set of equivalence class. I'll show an example, then you will understand. So, if you have a software that computes the square root of an input integer, which can assume values in the range of 0 to 5000. That is, if you have designed a module which computes the square root of a number between 0 and 5000. So, we have to develop some test cases to check whether that functionality is working or not. So, what we do is, we divide the input into set of equivalence classes and we take one test case from each equivalence class. So, in this example 0 to 5000, we have three equivalence classes. First one is set of negative numbers, that is numbers below 0. So, we have to check whether we get some output for negative numbers. What happens if we give some integers in the range of 0 and 5000? Then third is integers larger than 5000. If we give some value like 6000, then what is output? So, these are the three different equivalence classes. So, set of negative integers, set of integers between 0 and 5000 and integers larger than 5000. So, what we do in equivalence class partition, we divide it into three different classes. In this case, we have three different equivalence classes. Now, what we do is, we take one test case from each class. For example, in this case, we take the test case like this, minus 5, because this belongs to the set of negative integers. Then 500, so this belongs to the second class, that is 0 and 5000. Then we take another value, 6000. It is random. We can take 10,000, 20,000. Any value can be taken. So, it is larger than 5000. It belongs to the third class. So, we find out, first we, what we do is, we find out the different equivalence classes. So, in this example, we have three equivalence classes. Okay. So, we can have, there are some other examples in your text also. You can go through those examples. Okay. You will understand what this means. So, if we want to find, there are some examples like to find whether two lines are intersecting, then we can have different types of equivalence classes, like parallel lines will be there, intersecting lines will be there, then coincident lines will be there. So, we have three types of equivalence classes in that case. So, here also we have three different classes. So, we take one test case from each class and we test it. So, we test the program. So, we will give minus 5 and we will check whether there is some system crash or some error occurs. We will give 5000, we will see what happens. Then we will give 6000 and see what happens. So, this way equivalence class partitioning is done. And second method is boundary value analysis. So usually programmers may improperly use less than instead of less than or equal to, or less than, or instead of using less than or equal to, the programmer might simply use less than. So these are some of the mistakes that are made by the programmers. Or instead of greater than or equal to, the programmer might simply use greater than. Then there will be some errors that are occurring in the boundary values. So in boundary value analysis, we design test cases such that the boundary conditions are also checked, or the boundary values are also checked. So we design test cases using the values at the boundaries of different equivalence classes. So for the same example, if we have a function that computes the square root of integer values in the range 0 and 5000, what we do is we'll design test cases like 0. So 0 is the boundary value. So we'll include 5000 also. So these 0 and 5000 are the boundary values. Then one from negative class and one greater than 5000. So we will have 4 test cases in the case of boundary value analysis. So these are the two methods for black box testing. Okay. Equivalence class partitioning and boundary value analysis. So in boundary value analysis, we have to take the boundary values also, because this kind of mistakes might be committed by the programmer. So in order to detect those kind of errors, we have to take the boundary values also. So that's all about black box testing. Thank you.